Hi, I'm Stephanie Valinsky, Deputy Director with the Illinois Supreme Court Commission on Professionalism. Welcome to Reimagining Law. We're exploring how legal professionals are adapting the delivery of services for today's consumers. I'm joined today by Sandra Yamati, Chief Executive Officer of the Institute for Inclusion in the Legal Profession. Sandra, thank you for joining me.
My pleasure.
In the past several weeks, there have been public protests across the globe in response to the death of George Floyd and so many other Black people by police. In part, these protests aim to highlight systemic racism in our criminal justice system and also a lack of trust in many of our other institutions. What should the legal profession do to build trust in our justice system?
First, we have to understand the roles and responsibilities that we lawyers play in the justice system and work to pursue true justice, which means that, you know, regardless of your practice setting, we're not just talking about prosecutors and criminal defense lawyers or judges who preside over criminal courts. We're talking about the entire legal profession. And what that means is we need to get our own house in order. We cannot continue to remain one of the least diverse professions in the United States. That in and of itself would suggest to people that somehow the system is not fair and that justice is not being meted out.
And you talk about a diverse legal profession. Why is it important to have a diverse legal profession?
Because of the roles that we play in everything from the justice system to serving as civic and community leaders. You will often find people from our profession who are serving as government and public officials, that people from the legal profession are often the ones drafting legislation, and sometimes even in informal circumstances, being called upon to speak up for our fellow citizens. So that diversity in our profession is crucial.
In June, speaking about diversity, June is, as obviously you know, Pride Month. Would you say that the legal profession is embracing the LGBTQ plus community? And, you know, also with that question is, you know, what's the legal profession doing right and what's it doing wrong in terms of that community?
I think that in terms of our LGBTQ plus fellow lawyers and others in the legal profession, we're doing a better job than we have in the past, but not nearly as much as we should. I think that so long as we remain a profession where people who belong to the LGBTQ plus community don't feel that they can readily and genuinely be open about who they are, that suggests that we have a way to go. I think that there's always a lot of talk about allyship for the LGBTQ plus community, and that's important, but there needs to be action behind it. It can't simply be a matter of words or displaying a rainbow colored flag in our offices or cubicles. There has to be something more behind it.
And today, the Supreme Court, the U.S. Supreme Court, its ruling on the Bostock versus Clayton County, Georgia case came down, which protects LGBTQ plus workers from discrimination. Do you see anything of how this, how might this impact the legal profession?
I hope that it's going to. I mean, at least in terms of on paper, it's going to. But I do think we have to be mindful about making sure that it's implemented properly. We have to avoid what happened after Brown versus Board of Education, which is while the ruling was fabulous and we're all glad that Brown was did pass, what we have to remember is that oftentimes what happened is that, let's say in schools, you had perhaps teachers who were not of the caliber that they ought to be, but because they were white, getting to continue their careers as teachers of African-American students, and excellent African-American teachers who had had a passion for educating the young people in their community found themselves without a job. So I'm optimistic about the Bostock decision, but I'm also, I guess I'm a little cautiously optimistic. That's probably the best way to put it.
To be specific, what would you say are three concrete examples that the legal profession can do right now to improve the lack of diversity and inclusion in the profession?
We have to start by acknowledging that our profession, much as we might bemoan it, we are not a meritocracy. We like to think that this is an even playing field and people can pull themselves up by the bootstraps, but the fact of the matter is the legal profession is no more a meritocracy than many other professions. Then we need to start to dismantle the institutional racism that props up the systemic racism that we see throughout society. And by that, I mean things like we need to stop tying our diversity efforts to business development. We need to be able to pursue a more diverse and inclusive legal profession, regardless of whether or not we're going to see more money coming into our pockets.
And you had mentioned that we talk a lot about this in big law setting, diversity and inclusion. Can you comment on how the rest of the profession is doing or how they can also address it?
The burden can't just be on one practice setting or on one group within that practice setting, so that it manifests in terms of, you know, who you're thinking about hiring for any job in your office, regardless of the practice setting, whether you could be a solo practitioner or you could be working in a government agency or in some other environment. But to think about how the diversity and inclusion ramifications play out.
And since the death of George Floyd, the Institute for Inclusion in the Legal Profession started a new initiative called the Empathy Project. Can you talk about and tell us what that is and why you started it and the goal of it?
We were glad that so many Americans recognized the injustice that was done to Mr. Floyd and to many others like him. But we also thought it was important that the legal profession in particular understand that we're not immune. Just because we may not be the people in the blue uniforms that people are protesting about right now, that we also have just as much responsibility for the overall system as anyone else. And so we thought that one of the ways to do it is to be able to evoke greater empathy among all lawyers and legal professionals, because there's power in telling our stories. So we launched the Empathy Project with an eye toward giving people a relatively safe platform from which to share stories about racialized incidents in their lives, so that they could understand that this is not just something unique to a man who was unemployed. This is something that could happen to anybody. Originally, we got such overwhelming emotional reaction from this idea of people just so anxious to tell their stories. We thought we should do it relatively quickly, but now we're finding that more and more people want to tell their stories and that the stories are complex and sometimes painful. So we've extended the deadline to tell people that, yes, if you have a story that you want to tell, if you're a lawyer or a legal professional who would like to share how race has played into some of the experiences that you've had, we'd be very open to hearing those stories and finding a way to include it in a collective narrative.
Excellent. And what's the best way for people to do that?
They can send their stories to info@theIILP.com.
All right, great. And it's also on your website too, right?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. So obviously, as we discussed, we're, you know, in unprecedented times vis-a-vis social unrest, but obviously we're also, you know, amidst a global pandemic. So there's, you know, amongst all this, there's a lot of talk about reimagining the way things are done, you know, in the law, but also beyond. So how would you like the legal and justice systems to look, say, a year from now?
I would hope that in another year, we will see that our profession has adopted and implemented all sorts of new actions and initiatives to try to address these things. We had proposed several years ago, and we're trying to remind people that this might be a good way. We are suggesting that perhaps rules of professional responsibility need to be re-examined with an eye toward helping the profession be more current and relevant. We had suggested that there should be an ethical responsibility for all lawyers to take responsibility for the lack of diversity and inclusion in the profession and to try to remedy that. That's just one way.
Thank you, Sandra, for joining me. And please go ahead and like and share this video and subscribe to our channel to stay updated on new episodes of Reimagining Law. And information on how to stay connected with us is in the notes. Thank you so much for watching.